We're now traveling about 15 miles east of Surrey to the picturesque town of Fort Langley. We're in the historic town of Fort Langley. Behind me is the Fort Langley Community Hall. It was built in 1931. Behind me is the St. George Anglican Church. It was built in 1901. Here we have a nice example of British colonial architecture. This town is actually famous for its cranberries. In fact, every October they hold a cranberry festival. This is much better than yesterday.
Oh yeah.
What? This is the Fort Langley train station. It was built in 1915 and used until 1924. And it was one of 85 identical buildings in Western Canada. Right here is the Fraser River, and on the other side of the river is McMillan Island. It's named after James McMillan, who was the chief fur trader.
How are you?
I'm doing great. Have you guys been before?
No.
No. So you've been sort of updated on the programming?
We're at the historic Fort Langley. This fort was built in 1827 by the Hudson Bay Company, and it was originally built about 4 kilometers away in Derby, but in 1839 it was moved to its present location. And it was built to sort of open up fur trading here in the remote wilderness of British Columbia, because back then it was still a remote area. And this fort is also known as the birthplace of British Columbia because in 1858, when the province became a British colony, this is where the ceremony was held. Now, the entire fort was actually rebuilt in 1958 because, as you know, wood deteriorates quickly and it just sort of went out of use for a few decades, so only 2 original buildings survived. The rest was all rebuilt in 1958, and today it's a museum. At the time of its construction, the fort was actually the oldest building in British Columbia. This was here before any cities. Now, the fort didn't have a lot of success, as it had to compete with the large fur trading companies out of Boston, which controlled most of the fur trade. And another thing was that the Europeans were mostly trying to trade guns and traps with the native people here in exchange for furs, but the problem was that the native people here didn't really need them because they lived mostly off the river, mostly fishing for salmon. They were perfectly fine with what they had, so they didn't really need any of that stuff. This fort was actually built in sort of a significant location because this area was actually the northern border of the Oregon Territory, and the fort actually played a key role in establishing the present-day Canadian border.
For various items in the storehouse. Yeah, and then sort of carried in bales. So you'd have that across the forehead and then carrying the heavy bale on your back.
It's too big.
Well, my bellows, it's going to heat up my fire. More oxygen in my fire, the hotter it burns.
Now we can forge it?
Yeah, right now the surface of the metal is actually liquid, so I'm going to swing it off just to cool it a bit. There we go. So,
what is it for example? Да. Я мы там сейчас индусском спортом.
Пока.
Robert is reading some ancient trading logs. Oh yeah. Oh, I'll take the red one.
Good.
Yeah.
Great. Looks really good, you guys. Do you want a picture, like a photo, or are you going to just video the whole time?
Photo.
Nice.
I'm guessing these are British uniforms, right?
These are Royal Engineers, Royal Engineers, and they built the first roads here. So at this time, the road was the river. We didn't have roads in 1839. So they would come build the roads and also assist with the order. Because at this time, the time of this event right here, it was the gold rush. We had 30,000 Americans rushing the area for gold.
Oh, really?
So this is the reason why we needed law and order and structure.
Just make sure you sign this one right there. It's a very important document. Okay, Saya.
These are ready to go. All you do is rip off the top with your teeth, pour the powder down, and then wad up your paper. And pour that down as well.
3, 2, 1, fire!
Whoa.
Fire! Fire!
Fire!
Woo!
Woo-hoo! All right.
This was a nice trip. I've always thought of Canada as being a really modern country. In fact, it is a relatively modern country, Western Canada, anyway. So it was nice to come here and learn a little bit about the pre-modern Canada. We're now making our way north to Sasamat Lake and Port Moody. We're not exactly sure where we're going or why. We're just gonna drive towards those mountains and see where we end up.
Yeah, this is where the river is. You wanna check it out?
Yeah.
Check out the river.
Yeah. Let's go exploring. Oh man, nice.
Okay, we have the bald eagle here. It's natural habitat. Oh, it's beautiful. Nice eagle. More like Mount Baker?
Yeah, there was Mount Baker in Washington. It's about 40 miles from here. The dormant volcano. Oh man, nice. We're on Sasamat Lake. This is one of the warmest lakes in the area. It's just a few miles outside of Vancouver, and a lot of locals come here on the weekend to swim because the water is so warm. Are you going in? We've stopped at Rocky Point, and this may look like a small lake, but it's actually an inlet of the Pacific Ocean. We're now traveling about 10 miles outside of Vancouver to Mount Seymour Provincial Park.
Friday night.
Mount Seymour Provincial Park, and right now we're hiking to First Lake. This is what we've been walking through for the past few yards. There go my new shoes. We made it to the lake. More like a pond. And I thought it would be in a mountainous setting, but it's sort of just in this meadow right here. We made it to the summit. What a view. You can see the whole area from here. Over there you can see the San Juan Islands. Right down there you can see the, it looks like the Lionsgate Bridge. There's Stanley Park. And right there is downtown Vancouver. That's what I love about Vancouver. One minute you can be in the middle of a big city, but all you have to do is drive about 30 minutes north and you're in these beautiful remote mountains. Beautiful area. This was actually an unexpected trip, but it was worth it. Oh, shoot. Oh, shoot. Oh, shoot. The final stop on our journey is the picturesque town of White Rock, located just north of the US border. Same old story all over again. Turn a lover into just another friend. I wanna love you, I wanna make you mine. Won't you lay it on the line? And as you can tell from this enormous crowd of people, it's no ordinary day here in White Rock. In fact, it's a very special day because today is July 1st, Canadian Independence Day, also known as Canada Day. Now, Canada Day is actually the anniversary of July 1st, 1867, which is the day that three British colonies united into one country, which we today know as Canada. The holiday was originally called Dominion Day, but in 1982, when Britain lost all political control over Canada, they changed the name to Canada Day. Now, Canada Day is really no different than our 4th of July. Everyone has the day off from work. There are huge parties taking place everywhere, which conclude with a spectacular fireworks display. This is a famous white rock for which the city is named. It's a giant piece of limestone. And the legend says that the rock was actually hurled across the Strait of Georgia by a young Indian chief. But the real story is that it got here during the last glaciation. It's a glacial erratic, which means it's a rock that's not from the area. Because it was so unique, the rock was actually used in the 19th century as a beacon by sailors. And the reason it's called White Rock is because the local seabirds decided to use it as a bathroom. But these days, the birds have found some other place to take a crap. And the reason the rock is white today is because the city paints it once a month.
Hold on a second.
I must say Vancouver was not at all what I expected. The city has been exciting, chaotic, crazy, and at times even downright scary. But I'll tell you, as long as you get outside of the downtown area and explore the suburbs of Vancouver, you'll discover a wonderful area with a rich history, interesting culture, and friendly people. Vancouver, British Columbia! Woo!